Maybe a little faster. Not much.
Yeah, seriously. This woman.
Hang in there, Rocky.
She was throwing her elbow and got me right in the face. In the spin. And I spun her pretty hard, but she hit me. But I kept on dancing. I finished the song. You can believe that. I did do that. There's my...
Thank you. open to the door. Well, somebody help me sing. Somebody help me shout. Somebody help me sing more. Somebody help me shout. Get your mind on Jesus. Let's have church. Get your mind on Jesus. Let's have church. Get your mind on Jesus. Let's have church. Get your mind on Jesus.
Let him know you're in his house this morning, y'all.
All right. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day, and we thank you for this opportunity to come together and fellowship and praise and worship you. We ask that you be with the band as they bring the message and music, and be with Charkey as he brings the message and word. Be with all those on our prayer list, Lord, and we ask that you forgive us of our many sins and be with us, Lord. Lead, guide, and direct us in all that we do, for it's in Jesus' name we pray and ask it. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning, everybody. Are you glad to be in God's house? Amen.
Amen.
Well, it's good to see you. We got some... Chark got a lot of family visitors, dads over here. Good to see all these folks, some regular folks, folks watching in. We're all glad everybody's participating in this service. But it's good to, how many people were here yesterday afternoon? Just kind of raise your hand. Great job, great wedding. Congratulations, Dylan and Chloe. I don't know if they're here or not. Give them a hand. Well, the preacher wasn't so bad in that either, was he? Give him a hand. How you doing, darling? You doing all right? All right. Well, it's good to see everybody. Let's just have a good time here in the Lord's house this morning. In Psalms chapter 71, verse 14. But I will hope continually, and I will praise with you yet more and more.
Was standing by my window on one cold and cloudy day when I saw that hearse come rolling for to carry my mother away. Will that circle be unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by? There's a better home awaiting in the sky, Lord, in the sky. I went back home, my home was lonely, for my mother, she was gone. All my brothers and sisters crying, for the home felt so sad and alone. Will that circle be unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by? There's a better home awaiting in the sky. Undertaker, Undertaker, please drop slow. For that body that you are hauling, Lord, I sure hate to see her go. Will that circle be unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by? There's a better home awaiting in the sky, Lord, in the sky. Will that circle be unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by? There's a better home awaiting in the sky, Lord, in the sky, in the sky, Lord, in the sky.
Ah, praise God. All praise is His.
I couldn't manage the problems I laid on myself, and it just made it worse when I laid them on somebody else. So I finally surrendered it all, brought down in despair. I cried out for help, and I felt a warm comforter there. I came to believe in a power much higher than I. I came to believe that I needed help to get by. In childlike faith, I gave in and gave Him a try. And I came to believe in a power much higher than I. Nothing worked out when I handled it all on my own. And each time I failed, it made me feel twice as alone. Then I cried, Lord, there must be a surer and easier way. For it just cannot be that a man should lose hope every day. And I came to believe in a power much higher than I. I came to believe I needed help to get by. In childlike faith, I gave in and gave Him a try. And I came to believe in a power much higher than I. And I came to believe in a power much higher than I.
Praise God.
Amen.
Margie. Great job. In Psalms chapter 35, verse 28, Then my tongue shall tell of your righteousness and of all your praise all day long.
In the blood,
in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb. white as snow. Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
All praise is His. Give it all to Him this morning, y'all. Right in Mark chapter 8, verse 34. And calling the crowd to him with his disciples, he said to them, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me."
Freight liner truck late night pulled up to the roadside park. I was angry and tired, been driving for miles, it was way past dark. I heard the air brakes thrilling on the radiator grill, I saw the out-of-line sign of a cross. Then he dimmed his headlights and that cross shined bright through my windshield. Well, I was startled at first in the middle of cursing, I bit my tongue. Grabbed a hold of the bottle from the middle of my lap and screwed the cap back on. I got up and dragged my Charlie horse leg to his cabin, lit a cigarette. And when I asked him why the hell he had his light so bright, he smiled and said, "I'm carrying a cross, it's the least I can do." He carried one for me, I can carry one too. A reminder every day as I travel down the road. The life that He gave me, the light in my soul. For the next few hours we shared our stories about a life on the road. I reached in the back and tossed in my jacket when the wind turned cold. Heard his whole life story from whiskey days to glory to the gospel according to John. And then he gave my coat back, said it's time to hit the rack before moving on. I'm carrying a cross, it's the least I can do. He carried one for me, I can carry one too. A reminder every day as I travel down the road. The life that He gave me, the light in my soul. Well, I slept in my car beneath a blanket of stars till the early morning. When I reached for my car keys, I found what had left me the night before. In my front coat pocket was a keychain locket with a cross on the end of that chain. I remembered His words, both chapter and verse, as He pulled away. I'm carrying a cross, it's the least I can do. He carried one for me, I can carry one too. A reminder every day. Light in my soul, the life that He gave me, the light in my soul. I'm following the light that's burning in the night I'm carrying a cross.
Great song, great song. Okay, let's see.
I'm only human. Well, I'm just a woman. Help me believe. Show me the stairway. I have to climb. Lord, for my sake, teach me to take one day at a time. One day at a time, sweet Jesus. Jesus, you know, if you're looking below, well, it's worse now than then. Pushing and shoving, crowd in my mind. So for my sake, teach me to take one day at a time. One day at a time, sweet Jesus. That's all I'm asking from you. Just give me the strength to do every day what I have to do. Lord, help me today. Show me the way one day at a time.
One day at a time. Amen. In Isaiah chapter 41, verse 10, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand.
Why me, Lord? What have I ever done to deserve even one of the pleasures I've known. Tell me, Lord, what did I ever do that was worth loving you for the kindness you've shown? Lord, help me, Jesus. I've wasted it, so help me, Jesus. I know what I am. And now that I know that I've needed you, so help me, Jesus. My soul's in your hands. Try me, Lord, if you think there's a way I can try to repay all I've taken from you. Maybe, Lord, I can show someone else what I've been through myself on my way back to you. Lord, help me, Jesus. I've wasted it, so help me, Jesus. I know what I am. And now that I know that I've needed you, so help me, Jesus. My soul's in your hand. Lord, help me, Jesus. I've wasted it, so help me, Jesus. I know what I am. And now that I know that I needed you, so help me, Jesus. My soul's in your hand. Jesus, my soul's in your hand.
Give him all that praise you've been holding all morning. Praise God.
Wonderful job. Well, it's good to see each and every one of you. Good looking crew today. Let's stand. Let's just pray together. Father, we want to thank you for this day, and we want to thank you, God, for the opportunity to be in your house where we can praise and worship and glorify you. Lord, that's why we're here today. We're here because we want to just have another touch from the Master's hand. Lord, we want to hear a word that points us to Christ and helps us understand the love that God has for us and how we can in turn go and share that love with those around us. Lord, we want to thank you for the blessings that you give us each and every day, Lord. God, sometimes we forget to stop and just thank you for how you have look down upon us with favor. Lord, I pray that you'd be with my friend here today. Lord, I just pray that you would bring him peace in his spirit. Lord, you know all that's going on and things that he's thinking through right now, Lord. And I just pray that you would give him strength and wisdom, knowledge and restoration. Lord, we pray that you would be with his family, and we pray for healing upon all. Lord, we ask that you would be with Melinda today as she went through such a scary surgery just this week, and they had to go back in after this brain surgery and do more, Father. I pray that you would look down upon Melinda Price and bring healing and restoration, Father. I pray that she'd have a testimony that the Lord was good and that the Lord brought healing. Lord, things like this just really solidify our faith, God, when we all of a sudden realize that we're clinging to a master and you restore us. Lord, we pray for that, for her life, God, at this moment. Lord, even now I pray that she'd sense a healing Father, a miracle-working God, touching her and restoring. Father, we pray that you'd be with all the needs that we have as a church, Lord, our individuals who may be sick, those who may be struggling with cancer or other ailments, Lord. God, as we prayed for Melinda, Lord, we pray for this thing for them. Lord, we pray that you'd bring restoration, healing. And Lord, that we wouldn't take those things in vain, but Father, we'd throw our hands in the air and say, it's because of a redeeming Father that I've got restoration.
Because of a redeeming Father, I am healed. Lord, we ask these things in your name, in the name we're here to worship and praise today, in the name of Jesus, we ask these things in that heavenly name. Amen. Well, I want to give you a second to meet one another. There's several visitors here. My mom, or my dad and his lovely wife, Mary, my old Sunday school teacher, my young Sunday school teacher, and Sheila's father. Hey, find somebody you don't know. Meet them. We got donuts in the back, and we'll get started. Kids, you're dismissed.
Well, my dad says he's got a 6-hour ride ahead of him, so let's get it going. Guess we'll do that. I'm kidding, he didn't say that. If I could get you to make your way back to your seat, I want to make you aware of a few of the announcements. We've got our regular Monday night service tomorrow night. Dinner at 6:30 and service starts at 7 o'clock. Josh, good to see you today. Bubba, did you rope this weekend? We've got a Tuesday night team roping here. We had a little jackpot roping this last Tuesday night. Had a great time. But we got to practice this coming Tuesday night. Wednesday night, we have our regular Wednesday night services. Dinner at 6 and study at 6:30. We've been having a really wonderful studies right now through Psalms. And so come be a part of that. Then Thursday, we've got singles. We got our community singles event. It's going to be at the Sirloin Stockade at 6:30, right? 6:30? Yeah, so 6:30, Sirloin Stockade. So if you're single or you want to be, come on. We'll take you. So anyway, it's just a wonderful fellowship, good time together. Be here for that. Be a part of that. And then there's lots going on with the canned food. On the 10th of October, we've got our Truck or Treat Halloween weekend. And I want to encourage you, you got to be thinking about your event. What are you going to do? We'll park all the trucks out in the arena. We'll drop your tailgate, and then you'll have a game. Maybe it's a dart game. Maybe it's a roping game. Maybe it's a hoop throwing game. Maybe it's a dress a goat game. Maybe it's, I don't know what it's going to be. But anyway, come be a part of that. That is not just something that you hear and you think, well, I really don't participate in those type of things. This is something that we need you at. If this is your first time here, well, no, you've got something you need to do that Saturday, and we need you to be here. If you've been here since Jesus walked the earth, we need you here, okay? Guys, I want you to always remember that kids today do not live the same life we did. They don't grow up in the same homes that we did, okay? And let that burn in your brain. What we think is normal is not normal for children today. And we have got to create an environment where maybe just one time a year, these little boys actually see a big, strong, masculine guy with a cowboy hat on, pat him on the head and say, "You did good. I'm proud of you." Because church, all too often, our children today never get to hear anybody say that they're proud of them. They never get to have anybody, any male figure, come down and get down on their level and say, "I'm just glad to got to hang out with you today. I'm proud of you." So we've got to take this serious. And we may only see these kids one time a year, but we've got to understand it could be some of the most life-changing encounters that those kids could ever have. Remembering when the men and women love them. Got a couple of something that the band don't know about. I'm going to throw it out to them. Hopefully on the 13th, I think that's a Saturday. Saturday 13th? Yeah, that's right. I'm hoping to have a concert here by the band. Give it up for them. Give them a round of applause. Yeah. They just give. They're givers. They've got a giving heart, you know. And anyway, but we'd like to do a dinner as well as a concert here if we can make that happen. If we can't, band, I understand. But anyway, that'll be a fundraiser for the building fund. We've had a family come to me and say they want to give a $100,000 matching program. So they're going to give the church up to $100,000 if we can, but whatever we make, they will double up to $100,000. So we're doing a variety of things. We're selling t-shirts back in the back, and that will be part of the building fund to help raise money. If you would like a shirt, there you can fill it out back there. This dinner and this dance would all be about a building fund. But get this, the next November 20th, that Saturday, it's happening right here. November 20th, we are having WWF type wrestling right here. We got a group coming in. It's a Christian organization that does this. And I am going to top rope one of you guys, man. You are going down. Be $20 a ticket. People come in. We'll be selling vending stuff. And then during the halfway through the performance, it'll be a 2-hour program halfway through. Then I'll share a gospel message with the community, those who are here. So the guy called me up and said, "Hey, would you be interested?" And I said, "Man, you had me at WWF, dude." I mean, how much fun? I mean, how much fun seeing Randy, like, body slam somebody? No, we won't be a part of it. We'll just be hooting and hollering and throwing popcorn at them and stuff. So, anyway, so that'll also be part of the Building Fund program. Lots going on at the church. There's plenty of going on throughout the end of the year. So we'll be doing the boxes, shoe boxes for the children, overseas children, and actually here local children through Samaritan's Purse. Church, if you think about how much chaos it's been for us over the last year with COVID, think about what's taking place overseas. And truly, these boxes are going to be absolutely important. The community has a goal of 2,500 boxes. We've done 22 in the past. I say that's too short. Let's help them create let's have a greatest year that we've ever had of 3,000 boxes amongst the whole community, okay? That's my own personal goal. So it's going to take us to really see that as important. These kids who never get anything have gone through hell here on earth with this, with COVID and everything in these foreign nations. So we want to see that as our duty. We ask, what's the church do in chaos, in times of chaos? We love people. We love our next door neighbor, and we love those overseas. So anyway, lots going on, and I want you to be a part of it. I'm going to be in 1 Peter chapter 1, starting in verse 3 today. And I'm going to read a little bit, and then I'm going to share a little bit and read a little bit and share a little bit. It's just too much reading to read all through it and then break it back down again. What I like about 1 Peter is if you just had one book of the Bible, you could take 1 Peter and share the entire gospel. You could help somebody understand who Jesus is and our need for a Savior and our responsibility after salvation all through 1 Peter. And so it's a great book. It was written by a man who was a fisherman. He wasn't no scholar. He didn't have no degree as a Pharisee, but he was just a common man. But God changed his life, transformed his life, took a common man and made a great man of God out of him. And he wrote this. He was writing to the people in Asia, to the Christians in Asia, and he wrote this: "Praise be to God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." Here he says, praise the Lord. Praise this God. Praise be to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. He's excited to share this gospel with them. He first and foremost wants to praise the Lord. He don't want to just go right into the meat of things, but he wants to stop and say, praise the Lord for what God has done. And what has he done? He's given us new birth and a living hope. My dad is here today, and Sheila's father, Larry, and then my dad's one beautiful bride, Mary. I've known Mary my entire life. Mary was my Sunday school teacher. She was my Dana years ago, and she taught me with a little bee that had rubber bands on it, and you'd swing it and go, be kind, be gentle, be. Yeah, it's a little bee, and it bzzz, bee. Anyway, I'll never forget that. We learned the books of the Bible in Mary's class, and I went to Mary's all the time, and went with her children. She had a family, and the kids were my age, and I'd go over there and hang out with them. Mary taught me a lot. She taught me how to cuss there, and it was. I'm kidding. I've only heard her cuss once or twice. No, I'm kidding. She may have cussed when her and her boys and I were out on the lake out there on the ice, and that we got in a lot of trouble that day. Where were you, Mary? You should have been watching us closer. Anyway, Larry there, that's Sheila's dad. He builds hot rods. He's made his living building cars, and so it's good to have Larry with us today. And then my dad made a living. He was a mechanic, had a shop in Wichita, and so it's good to have each of them here with us today. My Sheila, my wife, the first time she met my dad, we went out to the farm, and she was amazed. She'd never been in that kind of environment, and she said, "Wait a minute, that cow don't have any horns. I thought cows had horns." And Dad said, "Well, some cows are born polled; they don't have horns, and other cows, when they're young, they'll actually remove the horn and cauterize it. But Sheila, that has nothing to do with these because that's my horse." And so anyway, she got to know the farm. But praise be to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Jesus talked about this new birth, this living hope, when he was talking to Nicodemus years earlier. Nicodemus came to him late at night and he said, "You've got such good teachings. They're pure teachings and holy teachings." And he was trying to understand. And Jesus told him, he said, "Nicodemus, you have to be born again." And Nicodemus, being a great Pharisee, a wise man, educated man, says, "But I can't go back into my mother's womb and be reborn." And Jesus began to talk about what new birth meant. And this is where we get the wonderful scripture of John 3:16 when he was talking to Nicodemus. "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth him should not perish, but have eternal life." Jesus talked about this new birth and said that as individuals, we have got to be a people with this new birth into a living hope. Baptism is a sign of that new birth. Whenever you're baptized, you are already a Christian. You have received Jesus into your life and asked him to forgive you their sins and be the Lord of your life. And what baptism is an outward sign of an inward experience. And it represents you are dead and buried. You go down into the grave. You go down into the water. But you are raised again as a new person. You have a new birth in a living hope. Because of this new birth, we have living hope. We have a new identity. Church, I want you to understand, when you become a Christian, when you have this new birth into a living hope, you have a new identity. Now, you still have the same talents. You still have the same skill sets. You may have received Jesus as a poor man and you received Jesus and you still don't have any money. You may have you received Jesus, but you still have the same earthly family. You still have the same hardships and the same challenges of life. You received Jesus, but you still have the same hardships. You still have the same challenges, but you do have a new identity. You see, when you become a Christian, you have a new identity. We are no longer people who are rejecters of God. We are no longer people who flee from God's will and God's plan and God's direction for our lives. But rather, when we say yes to the Lord, we are now sons and daughters of this living God. We have a new identity. It doesn't mean all of a sudden life changes and everything's perfect. But what it means is you have a new identity. You are no longer running from the things of the Lord. Rather, your desire is to now follow the things of the Lord. Because of this new birth into a living hope, we now have a new identity. Because of this new birth into a living hope, we now have a new heavenly family. We are now part of a great family. There's a wonderful song. I asked Tim and Aunt Margie if they recognized it. They didn't recognize it, but I think some in here today would. We are one in the bonds of love. We are one in the bonds of love. We are one in the bonds of love. We are joined in spirit with the Spirit of God. We are one in the bonds of love. Who knows that song? You do? Yeah, some of you. Yeah. Yeah, we are one in the bonds of love. I want you to understand, when you come to know Christ, this new birth and this living hope, then we are one in a bond of love. You see, we are now part of a family. We're a part of the family with the church down the street. We're a part of the family with the church and overseas across the ocean. And we are part of the family of God throughout time. You see, Peter someday and Paul, we're going to go up to these guys someday and we're going to be their brothers and sisters in Christ. Because we are one. Because of this new birth and this living hope, we now have a new family. I may be Marquis here on earth, but in heaven, I am known as a child of the King. Through Jesus' resurrection, we become part of this family of God. Because of this new birth and living hope, we have a new future in store for us. We have a heavenly future. A future where our inheritances never perish or spoil or fade, which is what our next passage says in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 4. Peter says this, "And into an inheritance that will never perish, spoil, or fade."
I asked Mickey if he would bring me a couple of awards that he won years ago, and he brought me this one. Isn't that cool? He brought me a little award here. Junior Rodeo, Waxahachie, Texas. I seen Mickey stick it on one. I seen Mickey ride a bull in the same arena as a 64-year-old. 63? 60? 60 years old. He won him a check in the same arena in the bull riding. But that's an old, old award. He brought me an old Buckley one years ago. I wore it last week, and he didn't even recognize it. He didn't notice I did. But anyway, he gave me an old buckle. It's kind of getting a little tarnished and faded. As I was writing my message, I thought about an award I got from the college. And I thought, man, I could use that. I can't find it. I don't know what I did with that thing. But see, in our passage today, that it says that we will have an internal reward that never perishes or spoils or fades. You see, that award that I received, I kept it around for a long time, but I'm not sure where it's at now. It's disappeared. Mickey had to dig kind of deep to find these old awards that he had gotten years ago. You see, the things, our inheritances here on earth will not last forever. I got, when Dad someday says goodbye to this earth, I will receive an old 1980s Jeep that he needs to hurry up and finish. All right? I want my inheritance to be in driving, not in boxes. And so anyway, he can do it. But anyway, I got an old Jeep, 1980s Jeep, and that old steel framed Jeep needs a top. Let's find a top, Dad. But anyway, I will get that, and he's got land up there that'll be separated between all of us boys someday. But church, I want you to understand that someday that old Jeep will be crushed. Someday that land will have somebody else's name on it. It will no longer be McGlasson or Marquis, but it'll have somebody else's name. Here on this earth, these things that we have, they do not last forever. They will tarnish. They will spoil. They will fade. Someday these awards will be put in a box or given to the children, who then will end up in a toy box or something someday and disappear. However, church, we have a heavenly reward where those rewards never perish, never spoil, or never fade. Our heavenly reward will be for all eternity. And the scriptures always say to build up your treasures in heaven, not be concerned about your worldly rewards. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, Paul wrote this. However, as it is written, what no eye has seen, what no ear has heard, and what no human mind has conceived, the things that God has prepared for those who love him. Isn't that cool? It says we can't even imagine what God has in heaven for us someday. That's exciting. What no mind could comprehend, what no eye has ever seen, what no ear has ever heard, is our eternal reward in heaven. Well, how often, church, do we spend our time chasing after the things of the world rather than being heavenly minded and storing our treasures in heaven? What are some of the things we're going to receive in heaven? What are some of the rewards that Peter is encouraging the people to remember? Well, first is a crown of righteousness. We will receive a crown in heaven, and later on in Revelation it says that we will take that crown and we will cast it at our Savior's feet in worship. But we'll receive a crown of righteousness, talks about in 2 Timothy. We'll also receive heavenly bodies. In Philippians chapter 3, verse 21, it says this. The Bible says that this is what it says. We will be transformed, our lowly bodies, so that they will be like his glorious body. We'll have a new body. It will no longer have the hurts and the pops and the pains any longer, but we'll have a new body. I hope mine looked like James Johnson. He's a stud. Yeah, I hope I look like James. More hair, but look like James, you know. Yeah, I want to look like James. We're going to have a new body. But in heaven, there's not going to be any heartache or pain. There's a beautiful scripture in the end of Revelations where it says Jesus will wipe the last tear from our eye. And I can imagine him taking that old robe and pulling the sleeve down a little bit and wiping the eyes, your eyes, wiping the tears from your eyes, saying it's all okay now. You see, in heaven someday, we will receive these eternal rewards. And Peter says these things are much greater than our earthly rewards that just spoil and fade and finally disappear. But we have an eternal reward. Going back to our passage today, it says this: this inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last times. Who through faith are shielded by God's power. Psalms chapter 57 verse 1 is beautiful. It says this: be gracious to me, O God. Be gracious to me, for my soul takes refuge in you. And in the shadow of your wings I will take refuge until destruction passes by. Church, I want you to understand that as Peter's reminding these people, God in heaven shields us with his power. There's a if you used to watch, go out to the park and watch the ducks, if you used to go out and feed the ducks, and you have all the ducks and you have some baby ducks, and if all of a sudden that mama sees a threat to those baby ducks, she'll have them ducks come in around her and she'll take her wings and she'll cover them and she'll shield them. And that's the example here today, that God himself sees the danger ahead and he says, I've got you, and he gathers you around and he covers you and shields you with his protection and his power. Church, I want us to know that we can walk in faith and we can have walk in confidence because this God of power is our shield. Goes on, Peter goes on and says this: in all this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have to suffer griefs of all kinds of trials. These have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith, of greater worth than gold which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. He's saying, look, you're going to go through troubles, and they were going through persecution at the time. He said, but it's just for a moment, but this persecution is going to create strength in you. Jesus said the same thing in chapter 5 of Matthew when he told the disciples, blessed are you when people insult you or persecute you or say all kinds of false things about you or against you. Rejoice and be glad, because greater is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets before you. Jesus said that there was going to be persecution, and Peter was affirming that in these people, that this is a part of your lot. If you say yes to Jesus, then there is persecution. There's troubles and hardships. Church, it's easy to be Christian when all things are going good. But church, when we all of a sudden stand in trials and tribulations, that's when we really begin to see what we're made of. It's easy to be a Christian when things are good. But church, our faith is tested when our jobs are on the line. Our faiths are tested when people begin to ridicule us for our faith. And we begin to think, well, maybe it'd be easier just to kind of pull back and not be quite so expressive in my faith. But church, trials make the weak Christian fall. Trials are what causes those in the four soils sermon, or the four soils illustration that Jesus says. It says that they're choked out by the pressures of life. They had no root and they were choked out as the sun, the heat came in. Church, we don't want to be the weak Christian, but we want to be the ones who are strong. And even in the midst of trials, we need to understand that that's part of the lot of life. If you're following Jesus, then the devil is going to do all he can to try to steal, kill, and destroy you. And so rather than allow him to achieve that in your life, you say, look, I'm going to follow the Lord. And my friends may come along or my friends may reject me, but I am going to be a follower of Jesus. Going on in our passage, it says, though you may have not seen him, talking about Jesus, you love him. These people had not seen Jesus when he was on this earth. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. For you are receiving the end result of your faith, the salvation of your soul. Concerning this salvation, the prophets who spoke of this grace that was to come to you searched intently and with the greatest care, trying to find out the time and the circumstances to which the Spirit of Christ in them was pointing when he predicted the suffering of the Messiah and the glories that would follow. It was revealed to them that they were not serving themselves, but you. When they spoke of the things that have now been told you by those who have preached the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven. Even angels long to look into these things. He begins to talk about salvation. He says that even though you did not see this Savior, even though you did not see Jesus, you love him. And church, I want you to understand that even us, as we have never seen Jesus, but we've learned about Jesus in the Word of God, the Holy Spirit reveals that truth to us in our spirits. God, I want you to understand that salvation comes in no other name but this Jesus. Just as these readers of this letter from Peter had never seen Jesus, they put their faith in him and their hope in him, we too put our faith and our hope and our trust in our Savior. Jesus, our hope, stands on nothing less than Jesus. Our hope stands on this name, on this blessed one who came and gave his life for the forgiveness of our sins. Our hope stands on this Jesus and the blood that he spilt for us. Our salvation does not come from our own goodness. We want to think that if we're just good enough, I'll hear people say that, well, when I get to heaven, I just hope that I was good enough. I'll hear that maybe on TV or maybe when I'm sharing with somebody. And guys, I want you to understand your goodness will never bring salvation. Scripture says that our goodness is of filthy rags to the Savior. Our salvation doesn't come by rituals that we perform. We're going to have communion here in a little bit, and your salvation doesn't come through an act of communion, but your salvation comes through grace, God's grace in your life and our faith as we stand upon that grace. Our salvation doesn't come from our parents. I come from a wonderful, godly family. My dad has been a godly man. I can honestly say this. And now he's still got a little life to live. I mean, he's got to keep it together. But I can't think of a single thing my dad has ever done wrong, as sinful. I can never say that I've seen my dad do anything that was wrong. I can honestly say that. I can honestly say that. But church, I want you to understand, my salvation doesn't come from my dad. My salvation comes from my relationship with the Lord. But he's getting older, you know, my dad. Mine's getting a little weak, you know. I don't know. Married Mary, she's wild. But I can honestly say that about my pop. Our salvation doesn't come from our parents' salvation. Our salvation comes from the Lord. Let me say something, though. I can say that about my dad, and I mean that completely and fully, but my dad is not perfect. Just because I haven't caught him don't mean he hadn't fallen short of the glory of God. He just may be real sneaky. We will all die in need of a Savior. But I can't say I've lived underneath the life of a man who's chose to live a holy life. Our salvation does not come from our parents. Our salvation does not come from rituals that we perform, and salvation does not come from our own goodness. No, our salvation comes from Jesus Christ, and his grace is sufficient for you. So what do we do? And our passage goes on to say this. Therefore, with minds that are alert and fully sober, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at his coming. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires that you had when you lived in ignorance. But just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, be holy, because I am holy. Peter charges these people, the readers, to be a holy people, no longer following the evil desires of this world, but rather to have a longing to follow God. We oftentimes struggle with that, the name holy. You know, God is all holy, and we are to be a people. This passage says we are to be a holy people. What does that mean? We're going to be God? No, we'll never be God. But what holiness means to us is we put those things of the world behind us, and we say, I want to seek Jesus. I want to follow Jesus. I don't want to be captive to the things of this world. I don't want to be captive to sin. I don't want to struggle with those things. I want to keep my eyes focused on the Lord. And when I do fall short, I repent of that. But I don't live in that. I repent of that. And I go on in God's grace. Church, holiness for a Christian is just a person who says, I am set apart. I am different and unique. I am no longer what I used to be. I don't live that life anymore. That I died to that. I am a Christian, and I'm going to allow the attributes of my family to be lived out through me. What are those attributes? Can we live a holy life? What are those attributes? Love of man. Can we love those around us? Can we look down upon others without a judgmental spirit, but look down upon them as fearfully and wonderfully made in the image of God? Peter, this same Peter, asked Jesus, how many times am I supposed to forgive those who wronged me? And Jesus said, 70 times 7, for other words, eternity, forever. Or to love. What does a holy life look like? A life of forgiveness. Looking when people fall short, when people hurt you, we're quick to forgive. We're allowed the Lord to have that situation, and we go on in peace and harmony and unity, and not allow unforgiveness to captivate our spirits. What does a holy life look like? Peace. Peace in our lives. Not chasing after the things of the world, not trying to climb on top of everybody else to get to the top, but rather living in peace with one another and with our Lord. Lastly, what's a holy life look like? Contentment in the Lord. And the joy for the blessings that he gives us. Contentment, which God's given us. And joy, because God truly has blessed us. Not chasing after the things of the world, but realizing that life isn't always perfect. But this life is what God has given me. Someday life will be perfect. And I'm on the other side of glory. What is a holy life? Love of man. Forgiveness of others. Peace as you walk through this life with one another and in your own spirit. And a contentment and a joy in the blessings of the Lord. If you just simply allow those attributes be lived out through you, you are living out the attributes of the Father in heaven. And we too be living a holy life. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for Peter, and thank you for this rough, tough, aggressive guy who took the time to stop and pin what salvation means. What it means to be a Christian, what it means to be a follower of Jesus. And Lord, I pray that we wouldn't leave here saying, oh, I can't be a holy person. Only God's holy. Lord, I pray that we would walk out of here saying, I can love my neighbor. I can be quick to forgive. I can live in peace. I can live in unity with one. Live in contentment. I keep my eyes focused on the Lord. Lord, I humbly stand before you knowing that we will all die in need of a Savior. You're not perfect in what we do at all times. We do fall short, and we're sorry for that. But Lord, I want to thank you that you're not up there looking at us with a condemning spirit. You're looking at a God that looks down upon us with love. Say, I got a better plan for you. Lord, I pray that you would help us to take this message, the message that Peter wrote couple thousand years ago, and apply it to our lives. Father, it's in the name of Jesus we ask these things. Amen. I'd like to ask those who are coming and being a part of communion if you'd come up at this time. I would encourage everybody, just keep a prayer for a heart at this moment. Let them usher these, and as they do so, begin to think about your life, think about circumstances. We get ready to take place, or we get ready to take